Good afternoon. My name is Daniel Babb, Senior Vice President of the New York Bankers Association's Profit Solutions Division. And on behalf of the association, I'd like to welcome you to this afternoon's webinar, The 8 Best Practices to Win Customers Using Social Media Content. We are pleased to have entered into an endorsement with Gremlin through the New York Bankers Service Corporation. And over the past 2 years, NYBA member banks have shown quite a bit of interest in the breadth and depth of tools and software features that Gremlin has to offer. Perhaps the most valuable being their unique approach and sensitivity to the importance of regulatory compliance requirements that so completely saturate the banking industry. I think you'll find that Gremlin is the ideal company to assist you with your social media needs, spanning all levels and disciplines within your bank. Now I'd like to turn the webinar over to Gremlin's CEO, Chris Maloney. Chris?
We're going to make best use of your time here to talk a little bit about social media. I've had the opportunity to work with dozens of banks here in my role at Gremlin with helping them to master social media and do so in a compliant way, and previously had done the same work at Wells Fargo and Experian at Scottrade, and want to share a few of the things we feel are best practices and opportunities for you to leverage to be a great social media player in the banking space. So, I hope you enjoy the next hour, and our goals for today, we're going to start with what we believe are the best practices. We're going to talk a bit about the risks and rewards of doing social media at your bank. We're going to talk about doubt and fear. So there is anxiety and concern, especially as it relates to what you're allowed to do and what compliance will let us do in the banking space, and we're going to talk about that. And, of course, how to overcome that doubt and fear and what we've seen as opportunities to leverage technology to drive social media success and to ensure compliance. And we also believe that by the end of this presentation, we can help you become a champion for social media as a growth engine within your bank. Our agenda, we're going to start by talking about some social media myths that exist in the banking space. We're going to talk about the evolution of social media and how we got where we are today in terms of social media as a business tool. We're going to talk about what type of content we are seeing banks leverage to be the most successful in driving new customers and engagement with existing customers, as well as engagement with employees and key partners that the bank may have. We have what we're calling the big reveal, which is what we see as a big opportunity in 2016 that only a small number of banks are leveraging. And so those on this call will be able to get an opportunity to hear where we see an opportunity for you to potentially leapfrog your competition. We'll talk a bit about social media risks and then the keys to having a marketing and compliance platform that works for your bank. So let's start with what some of the myths are in social media. First, the regulators don't want banks on social media. That's completely false. There have been dozens of releases from the major regulatory bodies and financial services that have talked about what banks should be doing in social media, and in fact have made it clear that banks need to be monitoring what's being said about them, what they're doing as a company, and what their employees are doing as a company. The key here is to have a process in place and to understand what the regulators want us to do to be in social media, but it's clear today that all of the regulatory bodies know that banks need to be in social media. Number two is if we really do social media, it will bury our compliance department with workload. Whether you're a small bank with one compliance person or a large bank with hundreds of compliance people, our experience is that out of the gate here, there will be an increase in needs from compliance to weigh in on how they'd like to handle social media content, social media activities, profiles, and the high percentage of social media profiles that exist out of the gate. However, in the end, by leveraging technology, we're very confident that technology can drive the workload down and help compliance to be more comfortable with what they're doing. The next question is regarding, is there a clear business benefit for social media? And the question there, I think, comes down to how can you ensure that you're measuring what's working for the business, how you're driving business using social media. It's not a fad anymore. and there's a real opportunity to measure the success, and we have some examples we'll share with you today. Continuing on, the notion that kids are the only ones using social media, that also is not true. While they're very active in social media, and I know anybody who's a parent sees their kids using social media more than ever before, we're finding that LinkedIn, Facebook, and Twitter are indeed places that are great business opportunities, and in many ways, the kids have moved on to other platforms. The next one, that I don't have time for social media. We hear this a lot, especially in the banking community. And I would say I feel the same way about email, and nobody feels like they really truly have time to keep up with email. Social media is becoming the next email. It's an essential business tool. We need to understand how to use it and master it and how much time we should spend doing it. It probably won't be as time consuming in a given day for business as email is, but it represents a huge opportunity to streamline and standardize how you communicate with customers and prospects. The next item is that LinkedIn used to really be about how to get a job or post your resume, and that is no longer the case anymore. If you've paid any attention to what LinkedIn has done over the last few years, it's very clear that they have become focused on being the business-to-business network, where business professionals, their customers, their prospective customers network and share information. And so LinkedIn is definitely a business-to-business opportunity today and a business-to-consumer opportunity. Next, I'm intimidated by the tweeter. Twitter is one of those platforms that has a lot of avid users. However, not everybody understands it or uses it, and we're going to give you some tips today on how to get started if you haven't used Twitter. Social media is not meant for business. That's absolutely not true. LinkedIn is a business platform, and more Twitter and Facebook are becoming the same, and there are great opportunities for your bank to leverage that. And last but not least, my bank is too far behind. We're too scared of compliance or legal or the auditors, and I think that's one that we can help with in the discussion of this presentation today. All right, so there's an opportunity here if everyone on the call is able to vote in the poll. We want to take a poll on what the size of your bank is, so take a moment now to click on the voting button, small, medium, large, or national bank. All right, we'll give it about 5 more seconds if you get a chance to vote. We have a couple who haven't voted yet. All right, and we're going to close the poll, and it looks like that the highest percentage, 38% of our attendees are with small banks. We have a few folks also from medium and large banks, and a small number from national banks as well. So continuing on, the evolution of social media. So everybody remembers 10 or so years ago, social media was still a fairly new thing. MySpace was still one of the dominant platforms, if you can imagine that. Facebook was new and had not really been fully launched. But as you can see by the green emblems at the bottom of the page there, social media was about interaction from customers to other customers. That's what social media was. It was interaction of people to people. Moving a few years forward, and I know this because I recall working at Scottrade, and we built a social listening platform where we were listening to what was being said about our brand, about any financial services products or capabilities that we offer, and we were learning from what was being said about us and understanding how social media is an opportunity to gain research and insights on what customers are feeling and saying about you and the services that you offer. 2010, social servicing. A lot of the banks, especially the large ones, started leveraging social media as an opportunity to listen to customer complaints, listen to feedback, and respond to that feedback by building a social servicing channel. And many of the banks on this call probably do have that today. Jumping ahead a couple of years, we see social branding. Many of the banks now have Facebook pages. They might even have a Facebook page for each of their branches. They'll have a robust LinkedIn presence, where most of their employees are attached to them on LinkedIn. They're leveraging Twitter to publish content, Google and Google Plus to get their information out to be findable to the audience that's looking for them. And social branding is a powerful tool. And most of our clients, truthfully, are in this stage of building social branding to talk to customers, listen to customers, and encourage those customers to talk to each other. What we see as today and going forward is what we're going to call social channeling. So this is something very new, but essentially this is leveraging employees and relationship managers or any customer-facing people within the bank to start leveraging the tool to talk to their customers and prospects. And this is a situation where the bank has to give those individuals guidance, but also monitor their behavior and ensure that they're doing what they should be doing in building their network online. We're going to spend some time today talking about social channeling. So we have another opportunity for a poll here. For all of the banks that are joining the call today, if you're able to vote on whether you think your social media presence and marketing effectiveness, how would you rate your bank today? Excellent, very good, good, fair, or poor? Please vote now using the voting buttons. All right, so if we close the poll, the largest answer that we got was fair. We had a number of people who said good, a few who said very good, and no one said excellent. And there are a few out there also who said poor. So when you think about that, clearly there's an opportunity that we recognize our banks could be doing a better job at leveraging the social media channel. So what's working? When we talk about content in 2016, it's important to consider the variables in being successful in social media include, have you established goals for what you're wanting to accomplish? Is it number of followers? Are these goals measurable? Is it how much engagement people have with your content? We work with our clients to make sure they have established SMART goals for their social media program and strategy. Regarding the audience, the content should educate your audience and solve problems. There's a huge mistake being made when banks think social media is another advertising channel to push product or to sell or to advertise their latest new thing that they want to push out to a mass audience. Social media doesn't work that way. The people in social media want to be engaged, they want to be informed, and they want to be educated. And so the type of content you publish must be very focused on appealing to that audience and how they want to be communicated with. There's no one-size-fits-all. Large banks and small banks have very different approaches. The smaller and community banks tend to be very community-oriented in their content. The larger banks tend to publish their own internal content, and medium-sized banks tend to publish a lot of third-party content. There's different strategies depending on your bank size. And lastly, on the size of your team. How many people should you have working on social media? And if you don't have a social media team, can you build a business case in order to get more resources allocated over the next year to help you be successful in social media? The goals that we like to see when talking to bank clients about social media include an opportunity to gain new customers. Clearly, that's a way to show growth. We have a number of banks who can say they've been able to drive new business through their social channel, and that's exciting because people can immediately see the value. But also deepening relationships with existing customers. I was speaking with a mid-sized bank last week, and a very high percentage of their followers and people who were engaging with them were current customers. So the content that this bank was publishing had to be written in a way that was appealing to their current customers, getting the most out of their banking relationship, and understanding that the people who are following you may be the very people who are coming into your branches. Customer education. So customers are looking for information about different types of financial products. They're often intimidated, and if they're going through some life change or life stage where they have questions about their own financial future, it would be great for them to see you, the bank, as an opportunity to get that information and education through videos or informational content that helps them understand where they should be focusing their attention. Community engagement is a big opportunity for banks to show they have a relationship with their community. The next one, employee advocacy and empowerment, might be one of the least utilized opportunities that I see. When you think of how whatever size bank you are, whether you have 20 employees, 50 employees, 200, 5,000, or 200,000 employees, leveraging those people who are using social media and engaging online, who are your employees, to help build brand and advocate for your brand represents a huge opportunity. There are centers of influence and partners that you can engage. If you have a lending group within your bank, they're likely interacting with real estate agents. We have some great case studies on how to do that effectively. Building brand awareness, obviously that's mostly online. People aren't spending quite as much as they used to on TV. Granted, we have examples like the Super Bowl where people are still willing to spend $3 or $4 million on a 30-second ad, and that's their goal of building brand awareness. It can be done much more cheaply, I assure you, leveraging social and online channels. And then customer retention and advocacy, helping to give your customers a reason to recommend your bank. That's a huge opportunity. Who are you talking to? So when thinking about your audience, historically, people have thought about the bottom left of the green boxes, prospective customers. I'm a bank. I'm trying to tell people they should use our bank. I'm talking to prospective customers. Or the bottom right, current customers. As I mentioned to you before, what we found in banking that the followers of banks tend to lean toward being current customers, although there are a lot of prospects on there as well. So knowing that you're talking to current customers. On channels, though, like Facebook and LinkedIn, we're seeing a lot of employees engage with the bank's content. So consider the top two boxes, prospective employees and current employees. Think of all four when you look at your social strategy. Who are you talking to, and what are your goals for each of those audiences? The other three external audiences I'll mention at the top are your partners who work with the bank, your community, and investors. In terms of setting goals, think of it this way. There are some foundational goals, looking at how many followers you have if you have a social media page, how many fans, what the engagement is with your content. Those are the foundational items. What we're seeing, though, that's really exciting is the forward thinking, looking at how to measure relationships, being able to attract new customers who come in through social media, understanding that when customers are looking for products or maybe even switching to a different bank, there's a unique purchase journey you have to be conscious of, and social media is a great way to engage customers in that purchase journey. And last but not least, one of the more advanced measurements is how to understand customers and when they engage with your content and being able to score them in terms of their likeliness to become a customer or to grow as an existing customer. This is a fun slide here. So we call this the Gene Simmons slide. Gene Simmons turned 66 recently. So if you were doing a social media post, maybe on the top left there, if you wanted to just be fun and do lifestyle-oriented stuff to get a lot of engagement, you'd say, Kiss frontman Gene Simmons turned 66. What's your favorite song by Kiss? Get a lot of engagement. I know from my experience with some larger banks, we got a lot of engagement when we asked these types of questions. But then the question is, how does that relate to what I offer as a bank? So let's go down below that and see that what a lot of banks do is talk about 401k rollover opportunities or maybe even offering a 401k rollover bonus or a unique offer. And that's a financial-oriented offer and an education-oriented offer. What I find really fascinating is the top right, when you can connect something that's culturally interesting and lifestyle-oriented but also talks about things like IRA rules and 401k rollovers that affect people who are over 60 and how those have changed, and that we're here to help you understand how to take advantage of that. So we believe there is an opportunity for you to find your content sweet spot and to try to leverage as much content in the areas that you find impactful as possible. This is an example that we used with one of our banks. All right, another opportunity to vote since we're talking about rock and roll. Let's open the polling for which of these four classic bands do you feel has had the biggest ongoing impact on music? Which one is influencing today's music? A, the Rolling Stones, B, Aerosmith, C, Alice Cooper, or D, Led Zeppelin? I've got a lunch writing on how you vote for this, so keep in the votes coming. And I have officially lost another lunch to a team member. So the winner of today's contest is the Rolling Stones, dominating the poll, and then tied for second, Led Zeppelin and Aerosmith, and in fourth place, Alice Cooper. I had bet my money on Led Zeppelin, so clearly I am out of touch. The Stones are still having a huge influence, which is great to see. Social media do's and don'ts. So I mentioned this earlier, and I want to reiterate it, and hopefully you find this as interesting as any emails that are popping up in the background of your computer right now, because I know a webinar in the middle of the day takes time out. But I think it's very important, if you're doing marketing of any kind, to not sound like a salesperson. Don't be too salesy in social media. That's not what we've seen work. Don't talk specifically and focused on products alone. Don't be pushy. It's not the same kind of promotional venue as a TV ad or a newspaper ad or some other promotion you might offer. And definitely don't repurpose traditional advertising or marketing that you've done. In terms of things that you should be doing, the social media do's. Number one, be findable. Your customers are trying to find you, whether it's a branch or a branch manager or an individual or a relationship manager, a loan officer, a financial advisor. They're trying to find you and they're trying to find people. Make sure that you show up. We have found one of the biggest mistakes that banks make is not being findable when folks are looking for them. And the risk is that that customer or prospective customer goes somewhere else if they can't find you online or on their phone. Many of them are searching on their phone. Think of how many times a day you do searches and what you do with the information you find. Thought leadership. We recommend sharing original content if you have it, sharing industry content from recommended publications or other sources that you think are reputable and reliable. Be sure to educate and engage. There's an opportunity to use social media as a really engaging, interactive way to communicate and not be just selling. Help promote finding solutions to find a customer. A customer is looking to solve a problem, be there with thought leadership that helps them solve that problem. Help me find other people with the same problems. We see communities and networks doing that. And last but not least, show me how others have solved the problem that I have today. Regarding choosing the right networks, the chart here shows six networks that we evaluated for a particular bank customer of ours. The primary three that virtually every bank can leverage are Facebook, Twitter, and LinkedIn. And there's an opportunity to measure whether that is a business-focused channel and has a business opportunity for you, or whether it represents potential risk and if there's any risk on the platform. In most cases, as you can see by the LinkedIn or In logo, LinkedIn is one of the best places to start because it's a business-focused channel with very low risk. Coming down to the secondary channels, there's a big business opportunity with Google+, but there's a lot of risk on Google+. We've seen some unique things happen that have created some compliance and other risks by things that are happening on Google+, Instagram, and YouTube are other channels to consider. And there's an opportunity for you to evaluate what channels should you be on and which ones should you start with. And I would look at the business opportunity and the risk with those channels. Mobile first. We say this really to all of our clients, and we all know this. We pick up our phones dozens of times a day. I was in a meeting earlier today where everybody had their phone out and was looking something up independently. And clearly, mobile has become how we interact with the web, even more than a desktop or laptop. So think about that with regard to social media. If you're posting content, make sure that it's short and snackable and digestible for someone who might be in the line at, I know in the East Coast it's Dunkin' Donuts and a lot of the rest of the country it's Starbucks. They're in line to get their morning coffee and they've only got a few minutes, but they'll read something or look at something you've posted. Make sure it's short and snackable and also shareable, something that's interesting that they may be willing to share with their friends. Keep them entertained, not just informed. Consider if you ask them to fill out a form to get information or to fill in things to get a response back, that you keep the form short. And there are great technologies out there today that allow you to do autofill, and I think we're going to see a big development over the next year making it easier to complete content and forms using mobile devices. Social CRM. Everyone at the bank who has a relationship with customers or any book of business with customers, whether it be a branch manager or any other relationship manager, needs to understand that social is now the most important CRM tool that they have at their fingertips. We find people in the financial space leveraging LinkedIn on a daily basis to understand who they're talking to and to build relationships. Know that your team members are using social. Many and most of your customers and prospects are on social. Your partners are on social, and you can connect even with team members and customers in new ways through social channels. understand that CRM is a huge opportunity for relationship managers within the bank, and that it is our job to help them to understand what they should and could be doing, and doing so in a compliant way. Community. So think about how you're building your digital and online community through social media and other channels. All of the customers of the bank, all of the partners of the bank, employees of the bank, this is your community. Are they following your content? Are they connecting with you on LinkedIn, Twitter, Facebook? Are you engaging this audience with content that's relevant and even user-generated content? And then, obviously, the bigger your network, the bigger your reach. Word-of-mouth marketing and being able to leverage word-of-mouth marketing and word-of-mouth advertising in social media, 92% folks believe that, and it's much higher than what they believe in advertising. So consider how your advertising may be impacting social media and whether you should be spending more in social media. All right, another time to vote. Do you view there as being risks for your bank being active in social media? And if so, is that high risk, moderate risk, average risk, or low risk? So from your perspective, do you see risk in your bank doing social media? Please vote now using the voting buttons. All right, so we have a pretty good even distribution here among the lower levels. We'll close the poll. We have a number of folks who said low risk and average risk. Moderate risk was about 15%, and the highest voting was on high risk. So clearly there is a concern out there that social media has risk. So we're going to talk to you about how to manage that risk. Before we do so, I think it's important to understand that social media is not just about what the bank's pages say, but it's indeed about what your employees, team members, and everyone who's involved with the bank is saying, customers included. We see a real opportunity to leverage team members to be advocates of the bank, leverage the social media channel to have them out there being the face of the bank going forward, and educating them as to what they should and can be saying about the bank on their LinkedIn profile, potentially on their Facebook or Twitter or other places that they have a presence. We find banking has a very, very high adoption rate on LinkedIn, and LinkedIn is often the best place to start with building team member advocacy, publishing content that your employees can share to their hundreds and hundreds of connections on LinkedIn. As an example, in the financial space, Putnam did research last year on financial advisors who use social media. And the average financial advisor who was actively using social media gained $4.6 million in incremental assets that were measurable from the social media channel. And of those who gained assets, 71% used social media on a daily basis. Now, don't be intimidated by the amount of time. We found social media can be very effective with 10 to 15 minutes a day of activity. And if it's a marketing department using a platform like Gremlin where you can schedule posts, it could be that you just spend 10 or 15 minutes a week and schedule those to go out over the course of that week. So there are ways to leverage the time commitment, but I can tell you the results are very, very measurable in the financial services space when individuals and companies use social media. But there are risks, and as we saw from the voting, many of you think those risks are high. So we're going to talk about the risks a little bit. Some research from Forrester indicated that about a third of the banks feel that they need a social media management tool in order to mitigate internal risk, policy violations or employees saying or doing something that they shouldn't do. And other research that we've done indicated that about three quarters of banks have employees who are creating risk in social media for the bank. So we're going to talk about some of those examples and help you understand how to mitigate those risks. There's been a lot of guidance from the regulatory bodies about things that you need to do as a bank in social media. So take a look here at your favorite organizations around the wheel on the right, from the FDIC, CFPB, FINRA, FFIEC, the Federal Reserve, SEC. A lot of these organizations have weighed in on what you should do with regard to social media and given guidance, but there's still some vagaries out there. The six things we know are, over on the left, You must have a governance structure for who's allowed to do what on social media. You must share a social media policy with all employees and anyone who's actively using social media personally or professionally on behalf of the bank. If you do post content, there needs to be a workflow process where you're tracking who does what on social media. You must have an archiving process to archive things that are being said about the bank or from the bank in social media, similar to whatever your process is today, let's say, for email. So think of this as the new email in terms of archiving. You're required to monitor what's being said about your brand or by your employees or from your customers. And last but not least, you need to be able to generate a report or an audit on what has been said or done in social media by customers, employees, or others. So keeping that in mind, there are five major brand risks as well. So these are things that can cause a big negative impact on the bank, but may not necessarily be violations of one of the regulatory bodies. Number one is your reputation. Every day we hear about someone doing something online that puts their company or their own individual name at risk. We're in political season right now, so we're seeing a lot of people say things and do things on Twitter or Facebook or other social sites. And your reputation, it's very important that you own your reputation and know what's being said about you. Number two is the risk that someone does or says something from one of the bank channels that could potentially be a breach. I had an organization recently that specializes in mortgages and found out that their main Google search results had been taken over by one individual loan officer for the company. And so that's a risk as well. Rogue employees who may be doing or saying something that you don't know, you're required to know what they're saying and potentially give them guidance on what they should or shouldn't be saying in social media. We've seen evidences of brandjacking where someone takes over a brand or represents themselves incorrectly. We had a financial services institution where someone who didn't work for them was promoting themselves as being the CEO of that company, and so we had to help them get that fixed. And then last but not least, things are being said online and you don't want to miss out. So there's definitely a fear of missing out. Your customers are talking about you and you can learn a lot from that. I know one example I can tell you is some of the major banks in the U.S. are using Twitter as a way to determine ATM network problems, and they can determine from Twitter what's going on in their ATM network often faster than what they can find from their own IT department. And so there's a way to leverage social media to hear what's being said about you. So here's an example of risk. So Bob McNamara, who's a certified residential mortgage specialist, would like to inform all of his real estate colleagues and clients that in order for the real estate market to flourish, you must vote for Donald Trump. He's the only person with a plan. You need to vote for Donald, and here's why. And he published this article. One of his colleagues, who's also in the space, said, good article. However, his company is supporting Bernie Sanders, and he's not sure how he could support Trump. So these are interesting conversations to have, I think, over a dinner table, but I'm not sure that you want your bank represented in the political domain where people are speaking on behalf of the bank saying that the bank supports or doesn't support a particular political candidate. There are risks, I think, to doing that. And here's a reason why real estate people should vote for Donald Trump and why this company supposedly is backing Donald Trump. And so these are the kinds of things that employees might do that would put the brand at risk, either from a professional risk or from a brand risk. Some other examples that we like to use, this is one from a while back where a company called Francesca Holdings, the CFO actually tweeted, had dinner with the board tonight, it used to be fun, now I must be on guard every second. And the next day he tweeted that he had a good board meeting, he had good numbers, equal happy board. Publicly traded company, does anybody see any problems with this? So the data had not been released yet about the finances of the company. Gene was fired, and the company was sued for releasing information illegally based on a fairly short tweet. And so you need to make sure that employees of your institution have guidance and controls on whether they do something that might potentially impact the bank. And this was an example of an institution that didn't. All right, another time to vote. Please take a look at this question. My bank uses a social media technology platform to publish and ensure compliance. Yes, no, or I'm not sure. Please vote A, B, or C now. All right, we've got a couple more people out there who are still voting. We'll give you another few seconds. All right, so closing the poll, there's a pretty good mix here, I would say. An equal number of participants said yes and no, and there were quite a few folks who said not sure. So about a quarter of you said yes, and a quarter of you said no, and the rest weren't sure. So I think it's important to understand what a platform might do for you, so we're going to talk a little bit about that. Building your social media strategy should have a foundation of making it easy to use for the people who are using it, whether that be marketers, writers, compliance department, or even relationship managers. Something that if they're not an expert in social media, maybe they haven't used Twitter before, maybe they use Facebook occasionally to connect with friends and family, maybe they have a very basic LinkedIn profile. But if you're going to get them to use social media and help them promote the bank, it needs to be easy to use. So I would start by looking at that. There are also opportunities to make content publishing very easy using a marketing library. So for example, you could have the compliance department look at articles that they thought were appropriate, put them into a library, and then departments or branches or individual relationship managers could publish those articles on LinkedIn, Facebook, Twitter, whatever the case may be, and knowing those articles are already pre-approved. Content calendar. So what we find in social media is there are certain times of the day where people are checking social media on their phone, and what we find often from banks is they publish whenever they decide to click send. I think there's a real opportunity to say our biggest impact is going to be, for example, at 10 o'clock on Tuesdays and 2 o'clock on Thursdays. That's when we've seen the most traffic, so we're going to schedule content to go out at those times. And having a tool that allows you to schedule content is very important. Some of that content is going to be evergreen. Some of that content is going to be very timely and relevant, but it should be scheduled into a calendar. Having a structure, we've already talked about all the rules that the regulatory bodies have given us in terms of compliance and governance. So having a structure that makes that easy to use and for content and updates to flow through the bank is a very important component. And last but not least, being a marketer, I know that the best way to get budget for next year is to be able to measure the success of what I'm doing. And so make sure your social media program starts off with goals and a measurement of what you're tracking to be successful. I think that's really critical in order to show that it's working and to increase staff and increase budget for the coming year. I had an opportunity with one of the organizations that I work for to produce a pretty large report on what our social media program was doing. It showed a lot of data about us being able to acquire new customers as well as build relationships with existing customers. And similarly, I can say it was just as interesting to senior leadership when they heard anecdotes about branch managers or other senior leaders within the organization talking about how they knew someone who had gained customers using social media. Those stories can go a long way. So there's a combination of qualitative and quantitative that you should measure and plan to measure in a social media program. All right, we have about 15 minutes left here, so if you have a question, please get ready to enter your question in the question column field over there to the right. 8 best practices. The reward of social media is greater than the risk. We know this. It creates some fear, especially in compliance departments, to be engaged in social media, but we also see it as one of the most positive ROIs of any marketing activity the bank could be doing. The reward is far greater than the risk. Number 2, that regulators do want banks using social media. They just want to make sure you have governance. Number 3, leverage marketing automation and compliance tools to make sure that what you're doing has a process and it's easy to publish content and to update profiles through the channels that you have within the bank. Know your target audience. Don't be all things to all people. We found some very targeted and relevant content this time of year. My big secret that I'll reveal since all of you dialed in to this webinar is that anything that contains discussions of what you need to do before tax day is really hot in a lot of people's minds right now. So it's probably the best performing content that a bank could publish would be 5 or 10 tips on things you need to prepare for in your financial world to be prepared for taxes. find your social content sweet spot. So understand who your population is, large customers, small customers, commercial customers, who you're targeted, and what kind of content would be relevant to them. Don't just push product. Look for something that's educational, informative, engaging, and interesting to the audience. Content is king, and think mobile first. Virtually every bank out there should be publishing content, and understanding that a lot of the things they publish are going to show up on mobile devices a high percentage of the time, so think about how to make that content easy for them to digest on their iPhone. Relationship managers are your social storefront, number 7. I cannot emphasize this enough. We have an example of a financial institution that has found that every one of their mortgage loan officers who are leveraging social media is adding incremental customers on a monthly basis through their social media channel. I also mentioned the 4.6 million in assets coming in to financial advisors who use social media. Think about your relationship managers and what they could be doing to be your social storefront and make sure that they have the tools and the guidance to be successful. Likes and followers and connections can increase your reach. A quick tip on LinkedIn, if you're on LinkedIn, it's a great tool and I do recommend using it, but I also recommend only connecting with people that you know and people who are true business connections of yours that you'd have lunch with. The description that I've heard that I like to use on LinkedIn versus Facebook is, if you would have someone over to dinner at your house, be friends with them on Facebook, and if you'd be willing to meet them for lunch, make them your connection on LinkedIn. Twitter can be just about anybody in the world. So 3 different tiers of how to make followers and connections using social. Key takeaways. The age of bank social media is upon us. We had a presentation last week with a compliance organization and law firm who said basically that every bank has to figure this out. It's in our face and we've got to understand how to do it. And it is a changing landscape because the regulators are adding new rules and suggestions and guidelines all the time. That is something we have to do now. The risks are there, but the opportunities are huge. If you are a smaller bank, and I know we had a number of banks who listened in today who said they were with smaller banks, look at the other banks in your footprint and what they're doing in social media and the opportunity you have to gain a competitive advantage over them leveraging social media. Technology can make things easier for your bank. We see this time and time again. There are great tools out there. Gremlin is one of those tools. There are others out there like Hootsuite that make the technology able for you to publish easy and leverage the capabilities that have already been built to make it easy for you to participate in social media. Regulators want to see governance. They want to see that you have the 6 things we talked about. They want to see policies, procedures, and that has to be built. Customers and employees want to talk to you in social media. So it's no longer an optional thing. Customers want to get a response if they have a question in a social media channel or they ask something on Facebook or have a question about your mobile app. Or we had a bank recently who had launched mobile check deposit. And they were getting feedback on their Facebook page about mobile check deposit, which was very beneficial to the bank. They were learning from this feedback. Your customers want to talk to you on social media. Be sure to be there. And last but not least, more than anything, your relationship managers urgently need to be educated on what they can and should do and be empowered to use social media, LinkedIn, and all the channels that are available to them. Make sure they're educated and doing so in a compliant way. Thank you so much for your time today. And for those who have listened into this webinar, we recently had a few slots open up from our department that does assessments on social media presence. And so for anybody who's interested in having us do a free assessment of your current social media presence, please reach out to our head of marketing, David Bell, david.bell@gremlin.com, or his phone number on the screen, and he'll get you set up to do a free assessment of your current social media presence for anyone who has joined this webinar today. All right, so let's see here. Let's start with some questions. We do have a question from the audience. We'd like to know more about banks that are leveraging social media successfully and who is leading in this area. So I will take one example here, and I can draw on both public information and my own information. An organization called the Financial Brand, and I would recommend anybody on today take a look at the website, The Financial Brand, and their comments on social media. They're one of the best at publishing thought leadership around social media and social media for banking and financial institutions. And what I have found is Wells Fargo is the top referenced in the banking category for social media. And I'll tell you a little about what they did without giving away too much. It started with understanding that the bank already produces a lot of content, and that content needs to be packaged into a way that's appropriate for social media channels. So turning that content into visuals, videos, and engaging, maybe shorter pieces of content. If you take a look at Wells Fargo's Facebook page, I don't know the current count, but I believe they were somewhere around 800,000 followers of their Facebook page, ranking them as one of the largest in the country. And they do a great job. So they would be an example of a large bank. For smaller banks, we did a case study for Navy Federal Credit Union. I wouldn't call them a small bank, but I would say they're in a different category because they're a credit union. And they do a great job of educational content, and they're another example you can find on the Gremlin website of a different institution that has leveraged content to engage their audience. And I would say the first goal in terms of how to be successful is to have a very robust presence from the bank on Facebook, LinkedIn, and Twitter, and to be publishing content at some interval that's relevant to you. You might start off once a month and move to once a week. We see a lot of banks publishing more than once a week, and we even have some that publish as frequently as twice a day. It's all a progression of adding resources to be able to publish that often. And I would say the majority of content we see being published by small and mid-sized banks is third-party content, an article from their local business journal or an article from the Wall Street Journal, depending on the type of bank, and saying, here's what we see happening with interest rates, or here's what's being said about interest rates and what might happen from the Wall Street Journal. So publishing third-party content would be a great way to get started. And I also, one other thing I look at is if you look at your bank's LinkedIn page, look at how many employees you have. And if you are a bank, let's say, that has 200 employees, your initial goal would be for at least half of them to be attached to your LinkedIn page. And I see top-tier banks around 70 or 80% of their employees being attached to them on LinkedIn. Some folks aren't going to be on LinkedIn, but if you get that number up to 75 or 80%, you've hit about the peak of what you can in terms of LinkedIn followers and employees. So LinkedIn is another great place to look for and what some of the best banks are doing. I have another question here on how long it takes to implement a social media platform. I would say the hardest part is getting your strategy figured out of who you want to talk to and what you want to do in social media. A company like Gremlin can help you make sure you own all of your social pages. But once you decide to go with Gremlin, we typically get a bank up and running in 30 days or less in their ability to publish content using the marketing and compliance platform. So it can happen in 30 days or less. Another question here, how much content should be original for a bank? And that really depends on the size of the bank. So my initial thinking is out of the gate, if you're new to social media, that a majority of your content, maybe 75%, would be coming from a third party, content that you've read and had compliance approved and you feel like is appropriate to share. 75% of that might be third-party content. That number changes as you get more sophisticated. We have some larger, more sophisticated banks where 75% of their content is original. So I'd say it's the swing of 75%, starting with 75% third party, and then as you get bigger, the majority of that content being original to your bank. If a bank executive endorses a political candidate, is there a risk to the bank? So that's an interesting question. I'm not sure that I've seen anything in the regulatory statements about politics. If a senior executive or relationship manager endorses a particular politician, I'm not sure that I've seen anything that would cause that to be fine-worthy. But I do think, knowing our nation and how politics falls in our thinking as consumers, that you run the risk of a brand risk of if you endorse a candidate publicly, are there people who don't agree with you who have a negative opinion of the bank going forward? So I'd say the bigger risk on that one is a brand risk. Another question here, what scares you about social media marketing from a banking industry perspective? You know, I would say a couple things. One is, the first thing which I've said as a marketer is it scares me when people are scared, when they don't want to do social media because they feel like they're going to mess up or hit the wrong button and something really bad's going to happen. We really haven't seen huge things happen negatively once a bank builds a strategy and a compliance methodology to track social media. We do think there's a huge upside. So I would say the first thing that scares me is people who are scared. But from a reality of social media, I would say not giving guidance to team members is the thing I worry about. There are some interesting duels here where there's some policies out there from the National Labor Relations Board about what you can or cannot ask for from your employees in terms of their access to Facebook. Are you giving them access to their Facebook? If they view their Facebook as being a personal platform where they get to say what they want about politics or family or friends or whatever it is, Facebook can indeed be viewed legally as a personal platform, and the National Labor Relations Board has weighed in to that effect. However, if your employees are using Facebook to talk about business, and we also have a process that we help our customers with here at Gremlin where you can create a separate business page if you're a financial services professional on Facebook so that you have a business and a personal page and keep them separate. But if you're using your personal page, you have to follow the rules of the bank and be compliant. And I think very few banks make it clear what you can and can't do on the social networks. If I look at and I hope one of the banks on this call asks for an audit, because I would say if I look at 3 to 5 executives and their social media presence, I can usually find some very drastically different approaches to what they think they should be doing because they don't understand what the rules are. So I think the marketing and the compliance and the HR departments need to be very clear with what employees are allowed to do or not allowed to do and give guidance to their employees. So it scares me when banks don't aggressively try to explain to their employees or teach their employees what they should or could do in social media. And last but not least, we don't have a social media account. Can Gremlin help us get started? So a little bit about Gremlin. We are a technology platform endorsed by the banking community to help do marketing in a compliant way on social media platforms. We're very focused on making it easy to use for a lot of people to publish content. But we also are happy to help if a bank is new and wants to set up a Facebook page, Twitter page, and a LinkedIn page. We're happy to help set that up. A lot of times the bank may have a marketing agency or marketing group that can help build some of that as well, and we are happy to partner with them to do that. Any other questions from the group here? I had one other question about the cost of doing social media programs and social media platforms, and that's a fairly broad question. I would say there are three things to consider in terms of cost. Number one is what internal resources can you allocate to social media? And I think that's the first place to start. What things do you think need to happen within the bank? So having a person in social media, or in the case of some of the larger banks, they now have staffs of 100 doing social media. The second question is the content creation piece. Are you creating content internally, or are you using an agency or a third party to create or define or grab content? So content is the third piece of cost or investment. And then the third is the technology platform to publish marketing in a compliant way. And Gremlin typically charges an annual fee for the platform and then a per user fee for the number of people who are using the tool. Happy to get into more about pricing and how we structure our platform. If you want to reach out to David Bell, his contact information is on this page, and he can walk you through anything else you have in terms of questions. All right, we're going to look for the question bucket one more time. Well, we've had great participation today. We appreciate you jumping in on some of the fun polls. Do reach out to David if you have any further questions or needs. And we will be archiving this webinar and turning it into a video and sharing it back with those who attended today for you to share with others in your organization if you'd like. So thanks for taking the time out to do this today. We really appreciate it. We know everybody's busy, and this is a very important topic, and we hope you got a lot out of our discussion today. Thanks, everybody, for attending.